In half an hour, Here and Now collars the charity watchdogs to find the real beneficiaries of British generosity. Before that on BBC One, Michael Aspel is a man with a mission.
Pierce Brosnan as 007, as ever, neither stirred nor shaken.
And here's the living proof.
You're late, 008.
I'm sorry, I thought you said 11, 007. Anyway, I'm here, and Pierce, you've made your first movie as Bond. How did it go?
It went well, Michael. It went well. It was bloody hard work, but we put a good film in the can, I think, and at a theatre near you very soon.
Absolutely. And the man that we're... Well, actually, you're not off duty yet because you're on a mission with us today, and the man that we're after is someone you've worked with. Is he tricky?
Can be tricky. He can be tricky. He has a short fuse at times, but a very good man and a wonderful man to stand beside, and for me, it was a great treat to be in this film with him.
Right. Well, if you'd like to go and soften him up now, I'll wait for your nod.
All right.
Thank you.
I'll go.
What a helpful agent. Now, what the producers of GoldenEye have done is to invite the media here to interview and take pictures of the stars of the film. The man we're after has appeared in no less than 15 Bond movies. To give you a clue, he's the one who puts the flash-bang wallop into the plots. And if security have done the job, he won't know anything about our plot.
Somebody
here I'd
like you to meet, Desmond.
Thank you, Pierce. Well, James Bond has turned double agent for us tonight, so that I can say to his old instructor Q, Desmond Llewellyn, tonight this is your life.
Mine? I can say.
This very night, we have Bond and we have Q. What can go wrong?
Well,
go
thank wrong. You. Thank go you wrong. Very much. That's terrific.
Well, good. I'm glad you agree.
Shall we? What a surprise. Thanks so much.
We have a very fast car waiting to take you to our studios.
Oh, well, thank you.
Desmond, all these years and all these Bond films, have you ever added up how much screen time you've had in the Bond films?
Yes. Oh, yes, I have. Out of all the Bond films, the 15, that is roughly 30 hours of screen time, 30 minutes.
Well, it's almost half your own film, isn't it, really?
Oh, yes.
Now, this programme and the Bond films have one thing in common, an efficient secret service. Working for us this time, your wife, Pamela, and your sons, Ivor and Justin, with GoldenEye producers, Barbara Broccoli and Michael Wilson. Now, let's see you at work as Q, briefing the latest Bond.
Look, let's ask Fred here to demonstrate for us. There we are. Sorry about this, Fred. One, two, three. Don't say it.
The writing's on the wall?
Along with the rest of it. Now, 007, do please try and return some... Do please try and return some of this equipment in pristine order. Don't touch that. It's my lunch.
And he's here, safe and sound, Pierce Brosnan.
Ha 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 ha!
Yes, very good. Come on.
Here you have the definitive Bond.
Oh. Well, that's from the horse's mouth. Did you feel yourself, Pierce, that you slipped smoothly into the role?
Some days more than others, yes. But I think certainly one of the highlights was working with Desmond here. I grew up with this man. I left Ireland in 64. The first film I ever saw was Goldfinger. And Q certainly is like the Merlin figure within the Bond movies. And as we all know, Merlin created magic. And Desmond, you have created magic. And I'm really proud to be here tonight for you. Lots of love.
Thank you very much.
Well, Bond himself has something in common with Q. I know that you don't actually get on so well with gadgets, but he has no problems with technology. He can do anything. Well, like all Bond's ladies, she's lived dangerously. Isabella Skorupko. Isabella, this, I know, was new to you as well, being in a Bond film, but Q was no stranger, was he?
No, absolutely not. I have to say, Q, and especially Desmond, is probably my biggest idol, my biggest hero. And I always want to ask you this question that you probably love. What is your favorite gadget?
Oh, don't ask me that. I loathe bloody gadgets.
I know that.
I thought I'd get that in anyway.
Well, I'm glad I didn't ask the question. Thank you, Isabella, and thank you, Pierce. Well, Desmond, you have been Q to 5 James Bonds in 15 films. Q, as the world knows, is the guru of gadgetry, helping 007 beat the baddies in all sorts of devious ways.
Now, pay attention, please. You see the gear lever here? You'll find a little red button. Whatever you do, don't touch it.
Now, why not? Whoosh. Eject a seat, you jockey. Ah!
Nobody does it half as good as you.
Strap it on your wrist. Be careful, will you?
Like this.
For Kamatsu, shake him, not stir. And for you?
The same.
How do you take him?
Straight up, with a twist. Thank you, mister.
My name's Bond. James Bond.
Ksenia Sergeyevna Onatop.
Onatop?
Onatop.
The latest evil beauty is in real life Famke Janssen.
Work together, unfortunately.
You didn't work together.
No, never. No.
You were certainly very nasty.
No,
in
thank
that
God
film.
For you. I probably would have killed you in the movie. So.
I'm sure you would.
Yes, your own gadget in the film is slightly less technical, isn't it?
A little less. Yeah, I just kill men the old-fashioned way between my thighs. Yeah. No Q gadgets for me. No.
Well, that lets you out, Desmond. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, Desmond Llewellyn, this is your life, and you were born on September the 12th, 1914, in Newport, Monmouthshire, and christened Desmond Wilkinson Llewellyn. Your father, Ivor, who was a colliery manager, died when you were only 16, and you and your late sister, Noreen, were brought up by your mother, Maya. You went to Radley College, where you shared a study with another future actor, the late Dennis Price. Mm-hmm. That's him there, and that's you. Now, at that time, you had a nickname.
You certainly did. We called you Loopy Llewellyn.
He also shared a study, Dr. Joe Bailey. Joe, why was he loopy?
Well, he was so fanatical about Rugger, weren't you? Do you remember in prep you used to spend at least one or two preps writing up the notes about the Welsh matches?
That's right, yes, and I did.
That was the time when you were reported to have been on OTC parade, when you saw a Rugger ball on the pitch, and you dropped your rifle, picked up the ball, did the full length of the pitch and touched down the other end before going back to your military duties.
If I may say so, that's balls.
That was the story that was told, wasn't it?
Well, you're completely wrong. Yeah.
But it was rugby anyway.
It was rugby, yes.
Yes.
And well, you're both still working. You.
Well, you may be loopy, but, or you may have been loopy, but we're both a couple of ancient Britons and we're still both able to work.
That's right.
Thank you, Bert, very
Thank
much.
Thank you, Joe.
Well, it's at Radley that you first become keen on the stage. You were in a school production of Bulldog Drummond in March 1931. Now, you left school in 1932, but your ambition to be an actor wasn't well received at home, was it?
No, it wasn't. So, I think my father had something to do with milk, and I was going into the milk trade, and they thought I ought to learn something about accountancy. Well, I can't add up, and I used to sort of stick stamps on, but I always put them on the wrong way round, and I wasn't at all popular.
Well, eventually the family relented, and in 1934 you go to RADA. You graduate to join the little theatre company in Southend-on-Sea, and one day in 1937 you bump into an old drama school friend who's working in rep. Your contract is coming to an end, and you're looking for the next job.
And my advice led to quite a different kind of a contract, didn't it, Desmond?
That same actor friend from 60 years ago, Derek Tansley. Come down stage. Right.
Well, this man is responsible for practically everything. I wouldn't have met my wife. God knows what would have happened. But I met him wandering round Southend, and as you said, that's I was it. At the Towers Theatre, and you were at Westcliff with Matthew Forsyth. And
that's he
said,
it.
Why don't you come and join us?
Yeah.
And I did. And
you did.
And yeah. That's the entire
story. And we
story.
Rehearsed the Scarlet Pimpernel.
That's right.
You became a regular of the company, and then. Many seasons later at Bexhill-on-Sea, Delaware Pavilion, there was a young actress called Diana Marley. Now, she had an elder sister who was not an actress, Pamela. Pamela came to see Diana, and of course, that was it.
That was it?
You got married.
Yes.
But Desmond, you're in your 57th year of that marriage contract. What about that?
Thank you, Derek, very much. Well, you marry Pamela in May 1938 at the Church of the Holy Trinity, Kensington Gore. You're with the Oxford Rep when war breaks out and you volunteer for the crack outfit, the Artists Rifles. You were at Sandhurst for 6 months before you're transferred to the Royal Welsh Fusiliers with the rank of second lieutenant. You were the regiment's only non-regular officer. 1940 sees you in action in France. The Germans were poised to trap four British divisions in a pincer movement south of Lille. Your regiment fought a bloody battle to keep an escape route open.
And you were sent with your platoon to take a vital bridge over the canal at Robeck.
He served with you, Second Lieutenant then, Michael Edwards. Michael, when Devlin reached the bridge, it had already been blown up.
It had been blown up. And it didn't stop Desmond. They're not going to believe this. It didn't stop Desmond getting out of his platoon sergeant and swimming this enormous expanse of water, which is the Labassie Canal, to set up an observation post on the bridgekeeper's house on the far side and set about getting yourselves organised. Well, very soon after, a large party of SS with tanks arrived and surrounded you and made you prisoner. And so there you were. And you were in a very dangerous position, as I say. And if it hadn't been for a lot of luck, a lot of fast talking, you wouldn't be here tonight, Desmond.
No, I wouldn't. No. For you, the war was over.
And then, well, yes, and then you eventually they put you into your wet uniforms and off you went and joined me in a prison camp in Bavaria called Leifen.
Right. That's right.
Yeah. Yeah,
the story so far. Thank you very much.
And there's Joe Bailey over there.
We have a picture of you while you were a POW. Now, another prisoner in that camp became a Member of Parliament after the war. Nowadays, he's Lord Peyton of Yeovil.
Well, Desmond, it's 55 years since we first met in that Laufen place. And then, by way of change, we went to Warburg. And you and I spent some months digging a tunnel together, which, when it was 85 yards long, the Germans had the luck to find by just hitting an air vent. And you happened to be underground at the time. I remember that quite well. And then the Germans, well, we had to tell them where the entrance was because they couldn't find it. And if we hadn't told them, well, you'd still be there. Well, Desmond, I hope you'll have a very happy evening. All your friends have thoroughly enjoyed your later performances. And tonight, at least, I'm very confident that you'll be more comfortable and a great deal better fed than we were when we first met.
Thank you, Lord Peyton. Well, finally released at the end of the war, after 5 years in captivity, you returned to your acting career. For a year, you played a policeman in A Spider's Web with Margaret Lockwood. Mm-hmm. 1947 sees you in Laurence Olivier's acclaimed film version of Hamlet. More films follow in the 50s, including The Sword of Sherwood Forest and A Night to Remember. In 1961, you make The Pirates of Blood River. And 2 years later, in 1963, you film with Elizabeth Taylor and Richard Burton in the epic Cleopatra. Did you have a lot to do in that?
I had four lines, which I dried. No, it was, you know, one of these long takes, and Roddy McDowell had a very, very long speech, and he went through it three or four times, and he fluffed every time he went through it. And that took the whole morning, and I was sitting there waiting to say my four lines. In the afternoon, he got through it, and I got up and stood up and fluffed. I think it's one of the worst moments of my life, but
I apologise. Can you remember what the lines were now?
No, no. I apologised to the director, and he said, "No, don't." He said, "I wouldn't have been in your shoes for anything." It was a terrifying moment.
One of your film parts was a Welsh tank driver in They Were Not Divided.
I cost 20 million division, chaps. Costume good and proper. Though you mark my words, wacky boy. There's something that'll always keep us away from the battlefield.
Turn it up, Taff. Turn it up.
No, let him say what it is. Vested interests.
The director was the late Terence Young, who remembered you when casting the Bond movie From Russia with Love. He was looking for someone to play the Secret Service technical wizard. You made your first appearance as Q in 1963. Originally, you were asked to play him as a Welshman, weren't you?
That's right, yeah.
How would you have played it Welsh?
Well, I had a long argument with him, you see. He said he wanted it as a Welshman. I said, no. And I said, all right, this lovely case I got here, I just press a button and out comes a knife. He said, all right, you win.
Yeah. Not so good in California,
no.
I should think.
No.
Now, John Glenn, you directed five Bond films, didn't you, featuring Desmond?
That's right. We used to really look forward to Desmond's appearances on the set. Because of the economics of filmmaking, all his scenes were usually lumped into a three-day stretch, which meant poor Desmond had to learn all this terribly technical dialogue. And the first morning, we were running a little behind, as usual. And at 12 o'clock, I could see Desmond pacing up and down in the background, trying to memorize some of his lines. And Roger Moore came over to me and he said, I've embellished his dialogue a little bit. Just slip it to him as a rewrite, will you? And I looked at Roger and I thought, well, this isn't really fair. But fortunately, the lunch bell went and I went over to Desmond with the rewrites and Roger was watching. So I said to Desmond, go along with it, Desmond, and we'll work out a little plan. So I arranged for one of the extras to come up in the middle of the scene after lunch. And on the board, we had what we call an idiot board, had all the words in very large letters. And Desmond managed to read it off and Roger was quite astounded because he really thought that Desmond had remembered it.
And he spoilt my lunch.
Later, we had a similar experience with a scene where he's demonstrating gas, and he has to wear a gas mask. And having removed the gas mask, he started on this very complicated dialogue and couldn't get it. And after about 30 takes, I said to Desmond, I tell you what, Desmond, keep the gas mask on and just keep moving your mouth and we'll dub it.
I could try that, and we have the proof, in fact. Yes. There we go. Quite a useful gadget, that.
Yes.
Now, an old friend of yours also becomes a regular in the Bond team.
Yes, and as the Minister of Defence, I was your boss.
You meet again, it's Geoffrey Keane. Because you've been good friends since your days in RADA.
Yes, yes. We met in 1935, that's 60 right. years ago.
60 years.
And, you know, Des, I always thought you remembered everything very well.
Oh, no.
In the end. It's very nice to see you again, Des.
Lovely.
Thank you, Geoffrey Keane.
Pamela.
Now, the great thing is that however far out Q's little gadgets might be, you know they're going to work.
It's time we said goodbye to an uninvited guest.
This is the part I really like.
In the early 70s, Bond films aren't the only part of your life. You appear as the Colonel in the children's TV programme Follyfoot. And hot-footing it here, your co-stars Gillian Blake and Christian Rodzka. Now, Follyfoot was all about a riding stable. Christian, did Desmond sit tall in the saddle?
Well, very rarely, because his character owned the place and he spent most of his time behind a desk. But I remember one occasion when you had a scene on a horse and you just finished rehearsing it when they called a tea break. Everybody went off, and while they were away, one of the horse girls, in order to give the animal a breather, slackened off the girth, which, of course, is the strap that holds the saddle firmly on the horse's back. You came back after the tea break, ready to shoot the scene, looking very gallant, put your foot and all your weight into the stirrup. The saddle ended up under the horse's belly and you in a heap on the floor. I think he preferred the desk.
But one of the first things, when I went there, they said, could you ride? And I said, well, yes, I hadn't ridden for about 10 years. And they put me on a horse. And I went away and I sort of started trotting and the damn thing took off. Well, luckily I could ride and I sort of held on and everything and I came back and it was sweating like anything, naturally, and they were furious. How dare you bring the horse back? I mean, don't you know? I said, look, how do you know I could ride? They said, well, you said you could. I said, look, I'm an actor.
Should have had your own ejector seat. But Gillian, four legs wasn't Desmond's lucky number.
No, it certainly wasn't. I remember on many occasions, Desmond, when you were saying your lines and would suddenly start up, donkeys in the background braying, horses doing, well, unmentionable things, but you kept plodding on and we got through, but I promise you, there are no donkeys and no horses here tonight.
Good. I hope you're right. Thank you, Gillian and Christian.
Thank you. Lovely. Lovely.
Well, back to the more organised world of Q, your 15th appearance in a Bond film just beats the record held by another regular and much-loved character. For years, she ran the office while 007 was out there having fun.
How I wished you'd invent a gadget to blow up those Bond birds.
Love unrequited the original Miss Moneypenny, Lois Maxwell. Now, you did actually get out of the office once, but it wasn't with Bond, was it?
No, it was with Desmond. No, actually, it was with Bond, too. We went to Portugal, if you remember.
That's right, yeah.
All of us were there, and that naughty Bernard Lee, whom we missed so much. And on this particular day, we had lunch in the barn, and he had scoffed far too much red wine, walked out of the door of the barn just as George Lazenby was coming on the big fighting horse, and he went up to the horse and said, "Have a drinky, horsey." And the horse snorted, pranced like this, and Bernard dove into a bed of sweet peas. Well, the horse went galloping off with George, and I went over to help Bernard up, and we saw that he had a terrible rip in the inside of his leg from the barbed wire, which was in the sweet peas. So I took him to the wardrobe hut and asked the lady to find a doctor, and after a few minutes, a man came, and he had a little black bag, and he didn't speak English, just spoke broken French, so we... He looked at the wound, he took out what I thought was an upholstery needle, sewed it up. He then took out a huge syringe and told Bernard to bare his bottom and shoved in the syringe and said to me in his broken French, "Madam, tell your husband not to take a drink for 3 days or he might die." And I said, "Well, thank you very much, doctor, for coming." And he said, "I'm not a doctor, I'm the vet." And this is the... And this is the first time I've ever given this medicine to a human. And you and I and the entire cast watched Bernard Lee for 3 days and he didn't take a drink.
What a romantic memory. Lois, thank you very much. Well, as Q, you came up with some of your trickiest stuff for Bond's trademark Aston Martin. After all the narrow escapes, it's finally been hijacked. I think they're here with their mums, your grandchildren. God. Jackie McAwellen, this is your life.
Thank you very much. How are we doing?